Hello everyone, Derek J here. It's about 1 p.m., a little before, on January 29th, 2015. And I'm walking with some friends. I'm walking with some friends to go to the State House where we're gonna testify on behalf of a bill, or at least I am. The bill is SB 116, and it's a constitutional carry bill, meaning that they're gonna eliminate the requirement in New Hampshire to ask permission to conceal carry. This is a special one for me because I've recently been denied permission to conceal carry here in New Hampshire by the local bureaucrats in Keene. That was quite a shock to me because, you know, I'm not a felon, I don't have a violent history, don't have any drug use crimes on my record, so I was really surprised. I expected to be approved. It's a shall issue state. Or at least that's what they call it. So, it would be great if they had something like what's called constitutional carry, like what they have in Vermont, where the Constitution is your permit. You don't need to ask anyone whether you want to carry a firearm, long arm, handgun, in your car, in your pants, on your hip, on your back, it doesn't matter. You know, you're a free human being, and you have the right to carry a piece of metal in whatever shape you want without asking any permission from the government. So anyway, we'll see how this goes today. I expect to say a few words, just keep it brief to about a minute, and I'll get a recording of that if I can. Peace. I'm standing outside of one of the pieces of the New Hampshire State House. This is around the back, and I wanted to get a shot of what is prohibited here. No dogs, no smoking, no food, but what I don't see are no cameras. Hey, how's it going?
Good.
And no guns. You absolutely can bring a gun into the State House, and people will be doing that today. Is it like that where you live? Hi, what are these?
Hi, these are stickers for the Women's Defense League. We're a Second Amendment advocacy and education organization here in the state.
Cool. Can I have one?
Sure, absolutely. Please.
I'm seeing a lot of people wearing these today.
Yes, today is a major bill for people who support the Second Amendment.
Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, Madam Chair, and members of the Senate Judiciary Committee. For the record, my name is Jeb Bradley, and I am proud to represent Senate District 3 in the State House. I'm here as the sponsor of Senate Bill 116, and I thank my fellow co-sponsors, Senator Booten and Representative Hull. Senate Bill 116 does four simple things. It's a modest bill, and it is a bill that I commend to you. Here are the four things that it does. It allows someone, unless they are prohibited in some way from carrying a firearm, to be able to carry a concealed weapon without a permit. It also repeals the requirement that we have now under RSA 159-6 that requires a permit in order to carry a concealed weapon. Thirdly, it requires the state police to negotiate reciprocity agreements with other states so that New Hampshire residents who choose to can legally have that permit to allow them to carry a concealed weapon in a state if there is a reciprocity agreement. And should somebody voluntarily choose to seek this permit for reciprocity purposes, it extends the validity of the permit from 4 to 5 years. That's what the bill does. The reason why I think it's a modest bill, there are several. First of all, what it doesn't do, it doesn't expand the number of people in New Hampshire, or if it were to be enacted in other states, it doesn't expand the number of people that are legally entitled under either our Constitution or the U.S. Constitution. It doesn't expand the number of people that are legally entitled to carry weapons, nor does it expand the number of weapons that are already legal in this state. What it does do is extend to New Hampshire residents the same protections under both the U.S. and the New Hampshire Constitution for concealed carry without a permit as people enjoy in our state to openly carry any weapon that is legal that they are legally entitled to own. That's why I believe this bill is modest and very much of a common sense piece of legislation. So if you're legally able to own a weapon today in New Hampshire, a legal weapon again, the simple change in this bill is that you will be able to have the opportunity for carrying that firearm in a concealed basis as opposed to having to get a permit. Currently, as I said before, under RSA 159:6, one must receive that permit, and according to the statute, one must be a suitable person to obtain that permit from the authority that grants the permit, and in most instances, those are local police chiefs. This bill has been debated, I'm told, numerous times in this building over the last couple of decades. But what has changed, and the reason why this bill has become even more important, is a New Hampshire Supreme Court ruling in 2013 that ruled that police chiefs, the permitting authority, have actual discretion as to what constitutes a suitable person, quite frankly, because we as the legislature have never define what suitability means. And so there is discretion in granting that permit. Unlike the situation with open carry, which is a right that anybody who is legally entitled again to own a weapon that is a legal weapon already enjoys in New Hampshire. So the bill makes that modest change to allow that concealed carry without a permit from the permitting authority. So, two critical questions, I think. Will this bill cause harm? I believe it will not. People who are going to commit a crime with a firearm are simply not going to be dissuaded by the need to get a permit to carry concealed, which, by the way, is a misdemeanor for the first offense if they don't have a permit. If somebody has malice or the intent to create malice, a violent crime, using a firearm, I don't believe they're going to be dissuaded in any manner or form by the law 159.6 that they have to have a permit to carry a concealed weapon. They are intent on criminal behavior. And in this state, I believe we appropriately treat criminals as criminals, but we reserve rights for law-abiding citizens to not be restricted by undue regulation. And we should focus our attention on criminals who are out to create mayhem or other violent crimes and not be placing impositions on law-abiding citizens. So you may ask a second corollary question that I asked as I thought about sponsoring this bill. And that is, especially in this day and age when we see so many incidents around the country and even international incidents, will the passage of this bill make New Hampshire less safe?
Yes.
Or more safe? That is the critical question, I think, before you and before all of us in the Senate. My answer to that is, I believe it will make New Hampshire more safe. In the United States right now, violent crime has dropped over the last year by about 4.4%. Those are the 2013 FBI statistics on violent crime. Over the past decade, violent crime in this country has dropped by about 15%. Now, there are a lot of factors that go into that. There's not one single factor, but I believe one factor that is important that we cannot ignore is that during that period of time, more Americans have availed themselves to the constitutional protections to defend themselves by owning a firearm. So what about the New Hampshire statistics according to the FBI? We are the sixth safest state in the nation. That's a pretty good place to be. But our neighboring state of Vermont happens to be the safest state in the nation. Our stats are roughly 199 violent crimes for every 100,000 people, every 100,000 residents, according to that FBI data of 2013. Vermont is 115. And I think, as a lot of people in this room know, Vermont has had what's known as constitutional carry, the ability to carry a concealed weapon without a permit for years. This bill, if it's passed in this form, I believe will make us more like Vermont in terms of rights and more like Vermont in terms of safety. And so I commend its passage to you. Again, it's modest. It does not expand who is legally entitled to own a gun, and it does not expand the number of weapons that anybody in New Hampshire is legally entitled to do. It treats concealed carry in the same way that we all have a right for open carry of weapons. So thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your testimony, Senator. Are there any questions from the committee? Senator Pierce.
Senator Bradley, going to the...
Senator Pierce, yes. You need to talk.
Okay, sorry. Senator Bradley?
No, you
can
hold
it. Hold it down.
Yeah.
Sorry. A quick question, or three questions. Looking at the first page of the bill, line 11.
get there.
Okay. So this would prohibit the issuance of a license to someone who's prohibited by the New Hampshire statute from having a firearm. Are you aware, and I'm not, this is a legitimate question about, are there prohibitions in federal law that prohibit someone from owning or possessing a firearm that are not in New Hampshire law?
Well, first of all, New Hampshire law cannot supersede federal law. So what is federal law is going to remain federal law, and it really does not need to be reflected in this legislation. So the legislation, I think, appropriately is written, because it's a New Hampshire statute, to reflect New Hampshire law.
But my question is, and it's not necessarily that the language is, I'm quibbling with the language, I'm just wondering, are there prohibitions in federal law from owning and possessing a firearm that we obviously, like you said, can't touch, and so therefore...
There are some prohibitions. Obviously, if you are a convicted felon, you can't own a firearm. If you are, if you've been committed in a mental institution, I believe that prohibits you from owning a firearm. Felony domestic violence, for instance, would be, you know, something that would prohibit one, or I think certain drug crimes also.
Okay. Yes. So those other categories that are not in the Hampshire statute, this bill would allow, well, actually, because we're a shall issue state, would require the police chief to issue a license to someone who has serious mental illness because they're in the federal law, that's not the case.
No, they couldn't. Anybody that's not legally entitled to own a firearm under state or federal law would be prohibited from either open carry or concealed carry.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Good afternoon, Senator Bradley. Do you happen to know in the history or the legislative history of why the process for obtaining a concealed weapon was determined to be different than the process for an open carry?
That I don't know, Senator.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator Brown.
Thank you.
Before we get on to other people testifying, there's a couple of things I'd like to ask of you that are here today. But first of all, is if you have a cell phone, please turn it off. If it rings while someone's testifying, it can be disruptive for that person. So please, as a courtesy, turn it off. Secondly, if you have written testimony, don't read the testimony. Try to paraphrase it as best you can. And we're going to ask you, because there are a number of people here today that would like to testify, please go, Senator Sanborn.
This bill has been considered in the House for a number of years. As the former member mentioned, this is a common sense piece of legislation that will make our state safer. I have in this folder here, and I will turn the entire folder in, the FBI statistics Senator Bradley mentioned, that Vermont is actually a safer state than us and has had this policy in place for a very long time. And that goes for both the 2011-2012 FBI statistics in the 2012 and 13, which are the latest ones that have been published. So I will be handing those in addition to other pieces of information. The senator mentioned that there was a court case this past spring out of Hooksett. That changed the rules. I have a copy of that court case that will be submitted to you guys as written testimony on why this is necessary at this point. Okay, up until this court case, we were a shall issue state. By the changes that were made by the Supreme Court, it gave complete discretion to the law enforcement officers issuing the license, taking us from a shall issue state to a may issue state. And it could be as simple as a person testifies in a non-SU2 town against the purchase of another cruiser, and now the police chief may be upset and chooses to not issue the license. It could be as simple as that, and now all of a sudden the citizen is faced with having to go to court to try and get a license that it should be eligible for. Further, I have in this large stack of papers a report that was put together by the FBI on active shooter instances. In this case, 64% of those that were mass shootings were over within 5 minutes. And there's 40-some percent were over within 2 minutes. The issue is one of response time. Even if we have the best of law enforcement, the response time to a shooting is not going to be sufficient for a potential greater loss of life. So this is where having citizens carry is actually in the benefit of the state of New Hampshire. Furthermore, people, this is an emotional topic, let's be honest. Some people like guns, some people don't. I understand that. But for some people, some small percentage of the society, they're concerned about seeing the firearm. It actually gets them nervous. And you know what? Concealed carry doesn't do that. There may be people in this room actually carrying firearms, and no one's nervous about it. And that allows for the peaceful society that we're interested in having. So not only does it make us a safer state, and it gives us citizens a chance to respond in time, but it also starts to address the emotional side of this, the reactionary side, when people express concerns about it. Oops. Sorry, I was expecting a desk. Can you hold that for a minute? I want to remove something out of here. This is the FBI report that I mentioned. And I quote, even the law enforcement was present or able to respond within minutes. Civilians often have to make life and death decisions and therefore should be engaged in training and discussions on the decisions they may face. That's part of the findings out of the FBI report. It is important that we allow our citizens to have a right that's entitled to them through the Constitution, okay, and not set it up that it's a mother may I type situation that we're then charging a tax on or a fee on for them to have a license to carry. Furthermore, in that stack of is a number of letters that were sent as emails to the senators on which I was carbon copied. I have submitted those as written testimony in case those individuals couldn't be here. In several of those cases, they contacted me directly and asked me to submit those as written testimony. Lastly, I have three copies of the beginnings of briefs of court cases, Supreme Court cases, and one circuit court case that deal with there is no requirement for police to act on behalf of individuals. And this is testimony or court cases that were pulled from various sites, domestic violence sites in particular, but it comes down that police don't have the obligation to respond to protect somebody. And unfortunately, these are tragedies on what happened, but law enforcement failed to arrive, and in the case of one mom, she lost her three children to her estranged husband, because he chose to take their lives, okay? Allowing citizens to defend themselves, allowing citizens to defend their families is an important thing. We as a state should not set ourselves up for liability, okay, because we prevented a citizen from protecting their own life. Now, with that, I'll close my testimony.
Thank you for your testimony, Representative. Are there any questions from the committee? Senator Pierce.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We're sort of told, we talked about the court case. Was it the same court case that Senator Bradley referred to?
Yes.
And I believe he said it was the court case that made this bill necessary, kind of gave it more urgency than we have.
Correct.
Did he?
Yes.
And is it because that court case gave, as I understand from what Senator Bradley said, from what he said, is that the court case gave local law enforcement discretion as to what constitutes a, quote, suitable person.
Correct. They went, if I can, they went and further defined suitable, okay, whereas the legislature had not. They came along and said the legislator has not defined it, so therefore we're going to define it. We're going to define it, giving complete discretion to the chief. So someone had asked a question earlier, when did this come about? And the original law goes back to 1923. I did the research on when it showed up in our statutes regarding suitable person. It's unclear what the rationale was for the term suitable. It was never defined. But back then, you had to be a naturalized and something or other citizen to be allowed to have a license to carry.
I agree that giving law enforcement unfettered discretion in determining what is, quote, suitable is a problem. And so I like the change that I see in 1112, the intent behind it, of actually defining and giving the legislature, making sure the legislature keeps it to itself the power to define that. But my question is, if that is the issue that made the bill necessary, why not just stop there? Why are we going further and rather than just defining or creating a new standard for suitability, which is, I think, acceptable, why are we going further and dealing with the permits?
So there are three reasons for that. Can you hear me or should I move the mic? There's three reasons. One of which is, I'm going to use what happened in New York, where a reporter went and asked for a copy of those who had firearms. In this case, it was an ownership record, and then published that list. We do have statutes that prohibit that release, but there's been questions of whether there's workarounds even for that, such that someone could go in a town, for instance, and ask for copies of every receipt that was for $10, hypothetically, right? Does that then generate the list? We have already, we have created a list that is followable somewhere. And given data security nowadays, it's important that if someone wants to carry concealed, that they not be on that list if they don't want to be, okay? They can carry openly already, okay? And the criminals, if they're already intent on breaking law, are going to go ahead and carry concealed. They're not going to worry about the misdemeanor charge. So what we're doing is setting a very high burden for the law-abiding citizens that's not in place for anybody else.
Yes. I was asking Senator Brandon a question about on line 11 of the bill. It simply prohibits the issuance of the optional license to an applicant who is prohibited by the New Hampshire statute. Mm-hmm. I'm concerned, or I'd like to understand, but I don't know the answer to the question. If there are federal categories of prohibited persons, but they're not prohibited under the New Hampshire statute, but they are by federal law, mm-hmm. Doesn't this mandate then that police chiefs shall issue a license, even though it's optional, but shall issue a license to someone who is prohibited under federal law from owning or possessing a firearm, okay, even if they are not prohibited under the New Hampshire law? And Senator Bradley, the example, I don't know if he specifically, but mental health issues. So wouldn't having it read this way mean that our local officials are issuing licenses to people who are prohibited from owning possessing firearms under federal law?
So part of this is a process question, right, on how it's my understanding that the chiefs currently do this. Part of this is what is actually in our statutes. So there are, under 159.3, there is a list of people who are prohibited persons, and those are prohibited from purchase, okay? It is possible for someone to commit a felony in another state that's not considered a felony here, maybe it's a misdemeanor here, and in that case, right, they would be allowed to purchase here. I think I got that right. I'd want to ask an attorney on that one. So that's the question of where you're going. In most cases, it's my understanding that the chiefs go ahead and run what is effectively a next background check on the individual. And in that case, if they show up with as a positive match to the prohibited persons list, that would be grounds for not issuing the license.
Where is that statement that you just made that they have
that process is not defined in statute that I'm aware.
So how do you get what's the basis for your statement?
Oh, conversations with other law enforcement officers and how they process applications currently.
Okay. Even though we're a shall issue state.
If I may, that is part of the process on right shall issue unless you. That's how they've been using the term suitable up until now, is they've deemed suitable or unsuitable in the case of someone who is a prohibited person by statute. That has changed. And unfortunately, the vast amount of discretion that was given by the judiciary to law enforcement officers unfortunately affects citizens in towns where there are still town meetings. And in those cases, they could turn around and oppose a budget issue, oppose a warrant article issue, and now there's a disagreement between the issuing authority and themselves personally.
How long does it take to obtain a permit to carry concealed weapons?
Currently, the statutes require that the chief issue a license. Currently, the statutes require the license to be issued within 14 days.
14 days?
Correct.
Is it unusual to, I've been told it's sooner than that generally. Is that
Depends on the chief, actually. In some cases, there's been issues with issuance within 14 days on a repeated basis. In fact, I believe there was an individual who took a case before the court for that. In other cases, the chief's responded.
And if denied, there is an appeal process, is that correct?
There is an appeal process, correct.
Do you know how long that takes?
I have no personal experience with that, and I'm not sure I could speak well to that. There may be someone here who has been on as part of the appeal process.
I appreciate that. Just one further question. Do you happen to know about the history of the concealed weapon? Why is it been determined that there needs to be a permit to carry a concealed weapon where there is not for otherwise open carry?
As I said, this first showed up in our statutes in 1923. The permit at that time had to do with naturalized citizens, foreign-born citizens. And I don't know what caused, in terms of an issue at the time, the requirement to be brought up before the legislature. It's not real clear in looking back at the House terms. And I have not found copies of any testimony that was given, so the only records that I found online were one of the former House terms.
Just one last question. Thank you. And the legislation you passed afterwards that was heard in 2004, and the disposition of that, obviously it wasn't passed.
It was passed in the House. It was passed in the Senate, and it was, I believe it was ID'd in the House the first time. This bill has come up in various forms, from the simple one that was before you in 2004 to the one that is effectively this today, a repeal of 159.4, to much broader bills in prior years.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Representative, only two questions. The first one is, why don't you co-sponsor the bill?
Because I believe in the principle that citizens should be allowed to protect themselves.
Second question, that's a follow-up, please. The second question is going to be on the form itself. On the form, DSSP, does it require to have three individuals that have to classify you as a good person or a bad person? In other words, somebody has to say you're either good or bad on that form.
That is currently on the form, and it's on the form, the 2009 version that was part of the bill.
Thank you.
Are there any further questions from the committee?
Seeing none, thank you very much for your testimony. Senator Hannan. The chair will call Susan Olson. Oh, excuse me, I'm sorry, Ms. Olson. The chair will call Representative Abramson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'll be brief. I'm Representative Max Abramson, and I'm asking you to support SB 116, also known as Constitutional Carry. As someone who was railroaded for acting in defense in my own home, I'm no longer allowed to carry a firearm, but I believe we are all safer living in communities where people are able to defend themselves. I do not believe that someone can always simply call 911. During the violent bloody brawl that occurred in my home 4 years ago, all three attempted murders happened before the police arrived. I do not believe that police officers, or that all police officers, care about your safety. Officer Hersey boasted that he nearly shot and killed me on the night in question and seemed to think that it was fun. The witness to that fact would not testify at my trial for fear of her daughter's safety. I do not believe that all prosecutors are motivated by an interest in protecting her. At my trial, the prosecutor lied continuously to the jury about life and death emergency that I was faced with. I do not believe that prosecutors are pushing for gun control to go after criminals. The prosecutor in my case brought those criminals back to testify against me in exchange for dropping felony charges against them. I do not believe that detached reflection can be demanded in the presence of an uplifted knife. Other witnesses said at trial that they saw a psychotic drunk woman come down with an upturned knife, moving as if to stab another woman in the throat. I do not believe that gun control is motivated by public safety. These criminals involved in the brawl had dozens of prior violent criminal convictions and outstanding warrants. All were let go by the Seabrook Police. Most have been involved in countless other violent crimes since then. I do not believe that all police chiefs honor the right to keep and bear arms or self-defense. Police officers admit that witnesses told them that I was acting lawfully in defense of my home and the people in it. I do not believe that police response always makes you safe. Seabrook Police admitted in their reports and at trial that they nearly shot my housemate dead as he ran for his life from a woman with a hatchet yelling that she was going to kill him for calling the cops. The gang leader who tried to wrestle the gun from me had to be pulled off by two or three of his friends. Despite outstanding arrest warrants and two prior attempted murder convictions, Seabrook Police let him go and he is now in jail for cutting a woman's face and for parole violations. The judge considered him too dangerous to post bond. I don't know why he and other members of his gang are now viewed by law enforcement as persons of interest in the brutal murder of Dennis Nico Jackson, only 1,000 yards from where I live. Nico was killed, burned beyond recognition, dismembered and decapitated, with body parts stuffed into a box, while other parts of him were floated downriver. I attended Nico's funeral and saw his orphan son and his two beautiful daughters, both of them babies. Like many naive people, I was surprised that prosecutors could knowingly target innocent people, that the Attorney General's office could lie to the New Hampshire Supreme Court, that police officers could get caught lying on a stand and get away with it, that juries could go against the weight of the evidence and convict someone who police admit in their reports was acting lawfully in self-defense. I do not believe that our criminal justice system is anything more than a bureaucracy run by self-interested lawyers, and I have never believed that it was a substitute for having a firearm available in a real emergency. I consider myself lucky that I happened to be armed when I was, or I might not be here to address you today. While I still suffer flashbacks from this near-death experience, I might have ended up like the many hundreds of thousands of victims of violent crimes in our country, men and women who were not allowed to defend themselves because lawyers were too busy making money. All of these things are a matter of public record. Please support SB 116, by September 1.
Thank you. Thank you, Representative. Are there any questions for the committee? Seeing none, thank you. The chair will forward. The chair will call Representative Sylvia.
Thank you, Madam Chair and committee. My name, for the record, is Michael Sylvia from Belmont 6, town of Belmont. I wasn't prepared to speak, but I'm going to just give you a couple of quick words that will touch on things that may not hear otherwise. Recently, I was looking at the Belknap County Jail report on inmates, and there was a person, an inmate, who had been charged with willful concealment. And I wasn't quite sure what that meant, so I looked it up. And actually, it's been repealed, so I'm not sure how that worked, but willful concealment is shocking. And the point I'd like to make on that is the idea of concealed carry. We don't have a concealed carry license, we have a license to carry. Concealment is a term used for someone that is hiding something. It has a connotation of criminal activity. And for good law-abiding folks to actually embrace that term doesn't seem quite right to me. If I could change the world, I would have everybody call it carrying discreetly. It's a little bit more appropriate. Another term that we see in the statute is suitable person. And Representative Hole referred to statute coming up in the 20s. And I saw some, and I don't know how credible it is, but there was an indication that there was some national model legislation brought about in the 20s and 30s addressing suitable person. And suitable person is essentially saying those people. It's a racist term, it's a code term. And in the, at the time, in the 20s and 30s, it was applied to Italian descent people. And I think it's offensive. And I think that suitable person it shouldn't be in our statutes. And those are the two quick points that I wanted to make. So thank you very much for hearing me.
Thank you, Representative. Are there any questions for the committee? Senator Catalano.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is a certain Solo. Do you have a license to carry concealed?
I do not.
Do you know what the form looks like? Follow up. Do you know what the form looks like at all?
Yes, I do.
And follow up on that, Madam Chair?
Yes.
Does it require to have three persons on that form to check your character and personality?
I believe there is space for three references, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any further questions?
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Still is taller than I am. I'm here before you today as the past chair and current legislative director of the Women's Defense League of New Hampshire. We are newly formed, less than a year old, but as the name implies, we are an organization that supports the education, training, and safety of women and firearms. I'm here today on behalf of the Women's Defense League to thank Senator Bradley, Senator Booten, and Representative Hole for sponsoring this bill, and to let you know that we support this bill. If I may, because I'm speaking on behalf of an organization, I'd like to refer to some of my notes. You have my full testimony and slide presentation in front of you, but I will abbreviate it, and with your permission, I would like to address some of Senator Pierce's questions regarding prohibited person definitions and also the issues on suitable person as it relates to the pistol and license application reference to the legislation and the legislative history from the early 1920s. We believe that Senate Bill 116 actually supports women's rights. Sounds sort of a strange statement to make, but we believe that this bill, along with Article 2A of the New Hampshire Constitution and the Second Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, absolutely affirm women's rights to defend themselves, their family, their homes, wherever they may find themselves. I'd like to give you a couple of facts on why we believe that the ability to have this license optional is good for women. The first fact is, you hear about women and domestic violence. I'd like to tell you that the fact is that the average assailant attacking the woman is 5 inches taller than 45 pounds heavier. If the woman must be engaged in an armed fight against a criminal assailant, somebody will be injured, generally the armed woman. Fact, research shows that women armed with weapons of any kind fare better against assailants than do unarmed women. A woman defending herself with a handgun is 2.5 times less likely to be injured than one who submits, and four times safer than one who resists by any other means. In fact, it is fairly indisputable that criminals, while a relatively small minority of the population, are by definition responsible for 100% of the crimes committed. We believe that instead of women being told that they must throw their cell phones at their assailants, they must call 911, hoping that help arrives in time, or suggesting that women carry rape whistles or soil themselves to fend off an imminent attack, why in the world would women in this room and everywhere in New Hampshire not suggest a common sense solution of women's self-defense and firearms training? Do we think that women have the right to go anywhere that they want at night alone if they choose? Yes. Do we think that women should have the right to dress provocatively and go anywhere they choose? Yes. Do we believe that women shouldn't live a lifestyle that they choose? Yes, we believe they should have that choice. What it means is women can't be selective about the areas in which they demand equality. Either we are helpless and doomed, or we take actions to these people as possible. Senate Bill 116 gives women the opportunity to level the playing field. We ask you to support women's equality, women's rights, and women's choices. We ask you to support Senate Bill 116. And if I may, Senator Pierce, the list of prohibited persons under the federal statutes, there are 18 of them, I'm not going to read them all, but they start with an applicant, that's the back of the pistol part of it, my apologies. It's a very small type. Under indictment, or one who has been convicted in any court of a crime punishable by imprisonment for a term exceeding 1 year. Someone who is a fugitive from justice. Someone who is an unlawful user or an addicted user to any controlled substance as defined by another federal statute. Anyone who's been adjudicated as mental defective, which seems like a bit of a pejorative term, but nevertheless has been committed to any mental institution. One who is in this country illegally. One who has been discharged dishonorably from the United States military. Someone who's given up their U.S. citizenship. Is subject to a court order that restrains such a person from harassing, stalking, or threatening an intimate partner, the whole issue of domestic violence. And finally, who's been convicted in any court of a misdemeanor crime of domestic violence. So those are the federally prohibited persons now that are mirrored in the Hampshire statute. On the back of the pistol and revolver license application that is referenced in Senate Bill 116, it says that applicants not prohibited under federal or New Hampshire law for possession of a firearm shall be deemed suitable persons in the license issue. The burden is on the licensing entity to prove by clear and convincing proof that the applicant is so prohibited from possessing a firearm. So it's pretty straightforward. The definition is not in statute, but it is on the 2009 Department of Safety Pistol and Revolver License Application. Thank you. We ask you to support the bill.
Thank you for your testimony, Ms. Olson. Are there any questions from the committee? Okay, Senator Pierce.
But Ms. Olson, isn't that part of this bill is to remove the reference to suitability? Suitability under this bill would no longer be the same. It would be on line 10, lines 10 and 11, we're removing the suitability standard altogether. And
what?
So we're limited now to only those prohibited under state law from carrying. I guess my question is even if foreign use of the term suitability, if this bill passes, that's no longer relevant. Is it that right?
Well, if my idea of the bill is correct, this bill basically codifies the 2009 Department of Safety Pistol and Revolver application, on the back of which it lays out suitable person. So once and for all, it would be persons not prohibited by New Hampshire or federal law. And I have a copy here for you, people. Certainly.
Senator Katama.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ms. Olson, looking at this handout you gave us, it's quite extensive and enlightening to read, by the way. How long have you been involved with this Women's Defense League?
With Women's Defense League, we joined it less than a year ago. I've been involved with the firearms zone for almost 40 years.
Follow up, Madam Chair?
Yes, sir.
What got you involved with firearms?
Thank you for the question. As a young woman, in a bit of an unusual field, I was in the coal mining business back in my 20s, and during that time, we were experiencing one of the last United Mine Workers strikes. The business that I was with was non-union, which won't surprise anyone in this room, but I also happened to be the daughter of one of the owners, and I was a pretty good target for the union guys who were trying to frighten us. They took a couple of shots at me. They didn't hit me. They could have. They intended to frighten me. They didn't frighten me. They kind of made me angry. Ever since then, I've been able to defend myself.
Is there any data that shows that women are been deemed less suitable or have had more difficulty in obtaining permits for concealed firearms than males?
Only if they are federally prohibited by law. I do not know about the discretion that's been exercised by local law enforcement. It has not been a problem for me or for the women that I know.
So it has not been, as far as you know, in your own personal experience, that has not been a problem getting a woman to obtain concealed weapon permit.
Well, it's actually not a concealed weapon permit. It is a license to carry a loaded firearm outside of my home.
Okay. That would be the appropriate license.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Senator Katama.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just another follow-up. Continue reading here. There's a fact here that talks about a woman defending herself with a handgun is 2.5 times less likely to be injured than one who submits and 4 times safer than one who resists by other means. Is that true?
Yes, sir. And I have about a 3-inch study here that I'd be happy to share with you on that.
Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony, Ms. Senator, and Ms. Olson.
Thank you, Senator.
The chair will call Eddie Cutler. Please come forward and identify yourself
on
the record.
Hi, I'm Ed Cutler. I'm the president of the Gun Owners of Vermont, and I'm here in full support of this bill. And I'd like to tell you why. Vermont, for over 220 years, have never had permits, have never had registration, and have never had any serious control laws. For 220 years, Vermont has been the safest place in this nation and one of the safest places in the world. Just last year, 2013, we were, by the FBI current reports, the safest state in the country. If you consider crime as far as firearms worldwide, and this could be checked out, I guess, through the UN or something. We are the second safest place in the world. The only people that beat us out on that was Switzerland. I'm also here to tell you a horror story. Unlike other states, I do have a New Hampshire permit, or concealed weapon, whatever you want to call it. Unlike any other state in this country, we have no permits. Because of that, we have a special thing that we have to do. In order to get a thing here, I have to go to my chief law enforcement officer and get an okay from him, written statement, and submit it with $100. About 4 years ago, my permit was pretty much run out. I went to, at the time, our county sheriff, name was Prue, and basically, she wouldn't give me that note. The current sheriff does, because she was anti-gun. I went for a couple of years without having a permit to come across from the state. And I don't want to think of how many times I've come across the state without that permit. I'm 2 miles from the border. I shot the New Hampshire. I live around Westminster. The closest supermarket to me is in Walpole. The closest place to go any type of shopping is down in Keene. Literally, there was no way I could have done this legally. It didn't matter what I did. I'd call the sheriff up, she'd sit there and say, I'll meet you in Townsend, which is probably 45-minute drive from me. I met you at the sheriff's office. I'd show up, she's not there. This particular sheriff actually got brought up on federal charges for all kinds of wonderful things, but she basically did in that county what she did. And I'm not trying to put down cops. 99.999% of the police in Vermont are great people. I have many officers in my organization. I have many officers that are good friends. But if you can pass this bill, I don't have to worry about another anti-gun sheriff. I don't have to give the state of New Hampshire $100 every 4 years, or if this bill goes every 5 years. I can just do what we've been doing in Vermont since Vermont has been Vermont. If you have any questions, I'm keeping this short so I can answer anything you want. I'm kind of an expert in Vermont and on Vermont statutes, so you're welcome to ask anything you want.
Thank you for your testimony, Senator Lansky.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Thank you for coming. I am just a little confused because you said there's no permit or licensing required for any type of weapon in your state, correct?
And never has been, yes.
I'm sorry, but why did you have to go to the police chief to renew a license, or?
A New Hampshire license.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you had to say Vermont.
Most other states, all you have to do is produce a state permit from your home state to get a non-resident. Because we don't have any, the rules are different. We have to get a letter from our CLIA.
I see. So it was a New Hampshire official that denied you?
No, it was a Vermont official who wouldn't give me one so I could get my New Hampshire permit. In other words, I need a letter from my chief law enforcement officer.
Because of New Hampshire law, though, not because of something in Vermont.
Right, both, absolutely. Yes.
Thank you.
Senator Tomlin.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And if I may, if this bill passes, we'll have reciprocity with New Hampshire.
Yep.
What other state is close to follow up that chair? What other state is close to reciprocity with New Hampshire and Vermont?
Any state that actually has constitutional carry has reciprocity with Vermont. We have no reciprocity with any other state. And because the only permit I have is in New Hampshire, a lot of states do not recognize non-resident permits, like South Carolina, North Carolina, do not recognize my New Hampshire concealed carry.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much for your time with us.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, the chair will call Mitch Kopass.
Good afternoon. My name is Mitch Kopass. I am president of Gunners, New Hampshire, also president of Pelham Fish and Game. So I'm here representing quite a few gun owners who are in favor of this bill. I think most of it has been said already. What I do want to say is, excuse me, all this bill really does is put us in line with what our Constitution says in Article 2A. And if you read Article 2A, please understand that it was passed in 1983. Not 1776. And it's funny, as I walked in here, I looked at all the statues and people that I see around here, and I'm sure they're wondering in their graves, why are you here? We passed a law that says that people can carry firearms. It is an inalienable right. Okay? And all we're saying is that I want to be able to put my coat on when it's cold, okay, and cover up my firearm and not go to prison. But that's what happens now. If someone has a firearm carrying open, it gets cold out, they put their coat on, they're now carrying concealed. They go to jail. And oh, by the way, probably for up to 3 years. That's carrying concealed without a license. So really, that's what I want to say. I'm here to answer some questions. Suitable person. You may recall that in this state there was a poll tax. Anybody remember that? What a poll tax is? It is unconstitutional. That made you a suitable person if you paid your poll tax. It also allowed you to vote, also allowed you to register your car. It was found unconstitutional, poll tax. We just didn't catch up with suitable. The references that Senator Cataldo keeps asking about, there's no requirement that they're checked by anybody. It's just that you put down three people that you believe or will say that you're okay. Most people are never checked. But the reality is law enforcement goes through a triple L check and when they do concealed carry license checks, so those people aren't checked. This does not eliminate the license. It just eliminates the need to get one. And I don't think we should have to have one. Now, under Article 2A of our Constitution, I'm not going to read it, you all should know it. You took an oath to uphold it. Please pass this bill. Any questions?
Thank you very much, Mr. Lopez. Senator Pierce?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Is it your understanding when in repealing the requirement of the license to carry a concealed weapon or firearm, are we eliminating all prohibitions on the unlicensed transport or carry of a firearm in a vehicle on or about one person, sort of over your concealed weapon?
We're doing just what it says, yes.
We are eliminating all prohibitions.
Is that what it says? Okay. Sorry, I've got to put my glasses back
on. It's really an interpretation. I'm asking.
Okay. Let me for my glasses, I actually do need these. It's not just to look for it. You're talking about Section 3? The availability of a license to carry a weapon. Okay, under this section, or any other provision of law shall not be construed to impose a prohibition. Okay, what I think that's referring to, and I'm not an attorney, nor do I try to practice law without a license, but I think what that's saying, and so I'm sure there's someone else much more qualified to answer this than me in the room, is that we're not saying that by eliminating the license, eliminating the need for the license, that we're eliminating that you can get the license. So in other words, if you actually want a license, like the gentleman from Vermont, to go and get carry in 22 or 23 other states, I can still get a license, and my police chief won't say, you don't need a license, go away. So that's what I think this section is in here for.
Actually, that wasn't
my
question. My question was,
no,
that's okay. I was reading from Section 3, but I was reading it all before.
Yep.
Knowing from which it is. But in Section 3 of the bill, not Rule 3, but Section 3, where we just repeal the requirement to get a license to
right.
carry a concealed weapon.
Yep.
Are we
firearm. I don't think it's a weapon. Anywhere in there.
Carry a concealed pistol or revolver.
Yeah, that's not a weapon, that's a tool, by the way. There were more people killed with hammers and bats than there were with firearms in the United States. Last I guess, sorry.
Are we effectively eliminating all prohibitions against carrying a concealed weapon without license?
Again, firearm. I'm sorry, I don't mean to keep going back to that term, but a weapon is a tool. Okay. If I take my pen out of my pocket and stick somebody, it becomes a weapon. I understand. So, I'm sorry, I'm trying to find the right section so I can read the words you're reading to myself so I can understand where you are. It's, I have section 1, section 2, section 3.
It's on page 2 of the bill.
Okay, got it.
17 and 18. Where we repeal Bill Transfer 2 requirement of a license to carry a pistol or revolver. If we pass that section, if we pass this bill, are we eliminating all prohibitions against carrying a concealed pistol or revolver?
Okay, I apologize again, I don't mean to come across this way. When I'm reading this page, it's page 2, line 17 and 18.
Yes.
On the page I have, page 2, 17 and 18, says repeal RSA 159-4 relative requiring a license to carry a concealed pistol revolver is repealed.
Yeah, that's what I'm
so it repeals the entire section of 159-4. I don't have the entire section of 159-4 here, so I can't tell you exactly what it says. It's not in here that I can see, unless somebody else can help me.
Yes.
Okay.
Senator Cataldo.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have a couple of questions.
Sure.
Maybe resolve that last question for us.
Thanks.
Let's do the last one first, 159-4. Well, 159-4 does now, if I'm correct, if you have a license to carry, you can have in your car a loaded pistol.
Correct.
If you do not have a license to carry, you cannot have a loaded pistol in your car. That takes that as one. That's 159-4.
I believe that's true, and then there's some hunting statutes that come in and get involved in that, so hunting and firearms are kind of fishy, no pun intended, but they kind of work together in there. But that is effectively it. Same thing with your jacket. You can't put a jacket on. You can't get in your car. You can carry openly, but the moment you get in your car and close the door, now you're carrying concealed.
Follow up,
Mr.
Chair?
Yes.
Go on,
Age.
I'm from Hampshire.
Yes.
Is that an affiliate for the National Pump Iron
Rifle Association?
National
yes.
Rifle Association?
Yes. If I didn't mention that, I apologize. Gun Owners New Hampshire is the New Hampshire affiliate of the National Rifle Association.
And one last question, if I may follow up.
Yes.
That was it.
I like that. That's when you answer my question. Thank you. Appreciate it. Anybody else?
Are there any other questions? Seeing none,
thank you very much.
The chair will call Senator Bob Clay.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. For the record, my name is Robert Clay, and I'm here representing the program in New Hampshire. And I can answer a couple of questions. One of the things I heard today before we started is that I heard that this was a solution in search of a problem. And I have to tell you that's totally opposite of what it really is. I'm a person that carries guns at times, and sometimes I have them in my vehicle. And last fall, my father-in-law was gravely ill, and I pulled into the driveway. I had a gun in the glove compartment, and my wife jumped into the car and said I had to go get my dad's medicine at the pharmacy. I never thought until she was gone that she was carrying a concealed weapon without a permit. Had she been stopped, she would have been charged with a felony for no other reason than she jumped into my car and took off. So it is a problem. My wife's a pillar of the community. She's much better than I am. She works with the poor because there was a gun in the vehicle. As far as what does 194 repeal? 194 says it repeals the provision that says you can't carry a loaded pistol or revolver in any vehicle. Specifically states pistol or revolver. So we repeal that. We say that unless you're prohibited from owning a pistol or revolver, you're allowed to carry one concealed. Whether it's on the person, in your car, in the back seat, you're allowed to carry it. And it's very important that we understand that we make people criminals by creating these provisions in law that make no sense. Why can't somebody that we know is good enough to buy a gun, why, if they pass that test, I don't know if any of you have ever filled out the form. There's a whole lot of questions, and they call up to see, they do a next check, and the MK's good. But then when you get it home, you can't carry it. I've had a carry permit for many years. Some of you know that I used to work with police canines. And I ran into problems going from state to state. I'm not the guy from Vermont. I live 2 miles from the Massachusetts border. In fact, I'm not the only one that's carried in Massachusetts, because anybody who carries and goes to the Fifth Lane Mall, just so you know, the parking lots in Massachusetts, you're technically in violation of Massachusetts law. It doesn't make any sense. So we bring this to you for the 10th year. Senate Bill 244, I was one of the sponsors when I was here at the Senate. And we had the same idea, making criminals out of people. And if you don't think it really happens, ask Evan Mappin about that poor nurse from Pennsylvania who carried a gun because she worked in a hospital in the worst part of the city that she could be in. She had been accosted 3 times. She went into New Jersey to deliver a birthday cake. She got stopped. She did the right thing when she was asked for a license and registration. She said, "Officer, I have a weapon." He said, "Let me see your permit." She handed him a Pennsylvania permit. He said, "Sorry, you're in New Jersey." She spent 3 days in jail before she found an attorney who could get her out. We don't need to do that in the state of New York. We should allow people, or we should assume that they're good until they prove otherwise. There's nothing in here that says a criminal can carry. There's nothing in here that gives anybody any rights that they don't have today. It just says that if you are carrying, whether it's your car or my car, you can't be arrested and charged with a felony for doing absolutely nothing. So I'm asking you to pass this bill and understand the people most likely to use this are women, and today, a lot of the elderly. If you haven't talked to elderly every time that they see somebody has broken in and done a home invasion, they're now looking to carry guns too. And I think about that poor guy who had 2 people break into his house in Manchester, and on their way out, they took his kid. Guarantee you, if he had a gun, they never would have let this kid pass the front door. So please consider that good people should be made known.
Thank you very much for your testimony, Senator. Are there any questions? Senator Lassen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Senator. Glad to be here. You have the bill in front of me?
I do.
Okay, the copy I have is page 2, when it talks about reciprocity, line 10. Could you enlighten me a little bit as to why you've got the director of the Division of State Police organizing and trying to negotiate reciprocity with other states?
Because we've had him trying to negotiate reciprocity forever. We've always done that.
Okay, and thank you. Follow-up. I know I've heard from the police chief in Annapolis, and he particularly finds that part of the bill, you know, fairly onerous on behalf of the chiefs of police. And at any rate, I don't know if there is another way to be done, and how do we, you know, tell other states what they're going to do?
We don't, but what we've always done in the state of New Hampshire is we've asked the state police director to work with other states to see what it would take to gather to gain reciprocity. It works the same way with snowmobiles, snowmobile licenses. It works on a lot of it. It's easier to use the state police than it is to try to use the National Police Department to work with Maine. It's the only central police department that we actually have in the state. By the way, you also made a statement. Why did we get permits in 23?
I'm sorry, why what?
Why permits came up in 1923?
I think I've been answered, but please tell me if you have to.
I was going to suggest that they probably needed to raise some fees.
All right.
Thank you. Senator Catalano.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Senator, you brought back a solution to a problem, and I have to ask you this question. You talked about a vehicle today, if you have a license to carry, I can have a loaded pistol in my car. If my wife drives that car and does not have a license to carry concealed, she now becomes a felon. That's true.
If she gets pulled over and is caught by a police officer, yes.
You want to follow up then?
Yes.
I think that's the reason why I had her, and now she now has a license to carry concealed. Thank you.
Are there any other questions for the committee? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Evans. Good afternoon, Senators. Try not to repeat what others have said. For the record, my name is Alan Rice, and I appear before you today as a member of the Board of Directors of the New Hampshire Firearms Coalition. We're an organization representing law-abiding firearms owners, manufacturers, and dealers. We strongly support Senate Bill 116. We urge you to vote it once to pass without any amendments or changes. I'm also here today on behalf of our partners, Gun Owners of America, the national organization which represents hundreds of thousands of law-abiding firearms owners. Gun Owners of America also supports Senate Bill 116 and urges you to pass the bill out of committee without any amendments or changes. As others have said, we've had licensed carry here since 1923. So we're in our 92nd year of allowing people to carry guns. But in the last few years, we've had some problems with people getting permission slips. Others have talked about that. I'm not going to go over the same ground. But what's important is New Hampshire, with all the guns that everybody carrying, is consistently ranked in the top 10 of safest states. Vermont is always safer. Senator Bradley said, I'd like to catch that influence, be as safe, if not pass that. We believe the right to own, carry, and use firearms for self-defense is a constitutionally protected civil right. Our founders did not contemplate citizens having to grovel to public officials for a permission slip. We shouldn't need a permission slip to exercise a right. It's also important to understand that the police do not have a duty to provide average citizens with protective services. The Supreme Court has ruled on this more than once. They can't be held civilly liable for failure to prevent a violent crime. So if you get hurt and the cops didn't prevent it, you can't sue the cops. Armed self-defense by law-abiding people has been proven to work. Last summer, a doctor prevented a mass shooting at a hospital in Darby, Pennsylvania. He used his concealed firearm to stop a gunman who ignored the hospital's gun-free policy. The police said that had it not been for the armed doctor, the criminal would have gone out in the hallway and walked down the offices until he ran out of ammunition. On New Year's Eve, down in Osceola County, Florida, a pastor prevented another mass shooting in his church, saved the lives of men, women, and children when he used his firearm to stop the shooter. We at the New Hampshire Firearms Coalition and our colleagues at Gun Owners of America trust our fellow citizens to follow the law and behave responsibly. If someone commits a crime while carrying a firearm, there are many statutes which provide for prosecution and imprisonment of those criminals. We don't object to the arrest and prosecution of real criminals, but as Senator Clegg said, you shouldn't be criminalizing behavior. The mere act of carrying a firearm concealed or openly should not be a crime. What we strongly object to is the practice of making otherwise law-abiding people ask government bureaucrats for permission carry a concealed firearm. We've seen far too many cases of these so-called issuing authorities abusing their authority and denying licenses to people who are legally allowed to own and use firearms. People who do not have a felony conviction in this or any other state have been denied concealed carry licenses. When this happens, the person has to go to court, hire an attorney, spend a lot of money, and a lot of time, and they don't always win. That's not the way things should be. The law-abiding should not be treated as presumptive criminals. Senate Bill 116 will put a stop to these abuses. Last year, the Department of Safety stealthily changed the application form for a pistol revolver license without any public notice, hearing, or attention. They slipped the changes in, and then when caught, claimed it was in response to a court case. We want to know who's in charge, who's watching over the Department of Safety. The statute says they designed a form, but
seems to be a little bit of lack of supervision. If SB 116 is law, the form is irrelevant. Currently, the license is recognized in 22 other states, as others have pointed out, under reciprocity provisions. The sponsors have wisely left the licensing provisions in place, allowing for the reciprocity to continue. And that's similar to what was done in Arizona and Alaska and Wyoming. People who live in those states can get a license to carry in other states, but if they never leave Arizona, they don't need a license. Again, for the reasons stated, we believe that this bill should pass without amendments or changes. I want to give the committee a few things. This is a package of letters that were sent to us from members of the New Hampshire Firearms Coalition, and I'd like to give you these paper copies to put into the official record of the bill. And I have copies of my testimony as well to meet with the committee. And I'll happily entertain any questions that the members may have, and I thank you for your time, your consideration, and your public service.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions from the committee? Is Senator Pierce?
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. On the first page, where it's repealing the suitability standard, replacing it with the words, unless the applicant is prohibited by the Hampshire statute from both owning and possessing a firearm. Can you tell me who that describes? Where is it in the law that defines who would fall into that category?
It was another RSA, I believe it's 159:3, but I'm not an attorney, and it defines certain persons not to have firearms, and it's convicted felons. So a felon can't have a firearm. Not a misdemeanor, not someone who runs a red light, not someone who forgets to get their car inspected, a felon. A murderer, a rapist, a beater, an abuser, felons. They can't have firearms.
And so has the licensing requirement that's in current law ever stopped a felon who has applied for a license from getting one?
I don't know. I don't issue licenses. I'm not an issuing authority.
Senator Catalano.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Rice, if this bill passes, we'll have reciprocity with the one, correct?
Well, it's actually the opposite. Vermont residents would be able to carry in New Hampshire without obtaining a non-resident license. Right now, today, New Hampshire residents and everybody else can carry in Vermont.
Yes. What's the closest state do we have reciprocity if we do pass this bill? And how do we get there?
Right now, we have reciprocity with Pennsylvania, the closest in mileage. North Carolina next. And then it goes down the eastern seaboard. Georgia, Florida, North Carolina, I don't remember the list, 22 of
them. Yes. So from New Hampshire, how do we get to Pennsylvania for driving a car? We can't go through Massachusetts.
Well, actually you can, you just can't go through a loaded gun.
Thank you.
You have to unload it, lock it up in the trunk, and get where you're going. There's a federal law that protects interstate transport. If you're legal where you start, which in this case would be in Hampshire, and your intended destination, which in your example would be Pennsylvania, you can travel through all these other states as long as it's unloaded and locked.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Are there any other questions from the group? Seeing none, thank you very much for your testimony.
Thank you, Senator.
Good afternoon, Madam Chairman and committee members. My name is Sergeant Sean Haggerty. I am the
commanding unit of permits and licensing section here at the State Police Headquarters in Concord. My function is the commander of the gun line, which does all the background checks for purchases through FFLs in the state by New Hampshire residents, as well as oversee the licensing authority for non-resident pistol permits. I know there's a lot of folks here that would like to speak. I'd like to keep my comments brief, but I would be available to answer questions. There's just a couple points that I'd like to make. First off, I heard a few comments early on about negative comments about law enforcement in general, and I find that to be a little bit disturbing to promote this bill. And I just want the committee members to know that my job I take very seriously, protecting the citizens of New Hampshire. I take my job issuing licenses to carry very seriously, and I'm sure that my counterparts throughout the state do as well. There are two real points that I'd like to make. One is the financial aspect of this, which I have no personal interest in. But I do want to make the committee members know, let them know that there is approximately $1 million in revenue that goes directly into the general fund for the issuance of non-resident pistol permits each year in this state. In addition to that, as you're probably aware, the local authorities collect the $10 fee for resident pistol licenses, and those fees are used at the local law enforcement level. The amount of dollars at the local level is unknown, but I can tell you that most large cities in this state issue in the range of about 1,500 pistol permits a year at $10 a piece. So in terms of this bill, eliminating pistol licenses, that's a policy decision, but you do need to know the financial ramifications of that. In terms of the content of the bill, there's been some statements made that I'd like to correct. First off is being charged with carrying a firearm in your vehicle, a loaded firearm in your vehicle, it's not a felony unless you've been convicted twice. That's a misdemeanor offense. So you don't in fact go to jail for 3 years. There were some other things stated that the sponsor of the bill indicated that prohibited in some way. I found that to be very vague. Prohibited in some way, according to the bill, is you are prohibited by New Hampshire law. Otherwise, the licensing authority shall issue that license. It's clear as day in the law, the way it's written and presented. In fact, there are only two statutes in New Hampshire that really prevent the possession of a firearm. And that's 159.3, felon in possession, as well as the protective order issued by a court. Those two statutes are covered in New Hampshire law. That's it. So void of those two things, the licensing authority, then that being the chief of police, selectman in town, would be required by this law to issue that license. As well as my office, with all non-residents, would be held to that same standard. It would make the administrative rules that have the force of law, that are authorized through the legislature, null and void for non-resident pistol licenses. This was described as a modest bill, and that it doesn't expand the number of people legally able to possess weapons or firearms. From my previous statement, it's clear to see that it would, because suitability has been determined in the past by a number of factors, whether it be criminal record check, and certainly the 10 federal disqualifiers that prevent possession, transport, purchase of firearms and ammunition. based on Title 18 federal law. New Hampshire only includes two of those. So you've got eight federal disqualifiers that would prevent someone from possessing, purchasing, transporting firearms that would, you'd be basically telling the issuing authority issue that license despite the fact that federal law prevents that person from possessing a firearm. And I'm not all that comfortable of violating federal law or aiding and abetting. Parking tickets have never been a reason to deny a pistol license. And I don't believe it ever will. That was said here today. And we are a long way from New Jersey gun laws. A long way. That's all I have. I'd like to take questions, Kevin.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Senator Pierce.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm sorry, I have you for coming in. Did the bill's sponsors reach out to you or to anyone in law enforcement that you know of?
Not that I'm aware of, sir.
And I noted in the written testimony that the Department of Safety is opposed, and you need to give the reasons for that. Have you heard from any other part of law enforcement, like local law enforcement or sheriffs or anybody who's calling for this bill?
I have, and my office receives many inquiries from the local authorities historically in some guidance and in questions about the law. And suitability, as has been said here, has been left open and not defined. But we have a system in place as it exists today that allows a person who is denied the ability within 30 days, this is a question that was asked earlier, within 30 days of that denial to make a written notice to the court, the district court, and within 14 days of that notice to the court, a hearing is required where that issuing authority is required to show proof on why that denial should be sustained.
The reciprocal jurisdictions, I think it was mentioned that the closest one was Pennsylvania, and then the next one down was North Carolina. Why is it such a patchwork? Why don't we have reciprocity with all 50 states? Is it because the entry standards for a license are different than those other states? And could you explain to me?
That's generally correct. New Hampshire has no photographs, fingerprints. No database that's available nationally to check your license status. No training requirements to issue a license. Many, many states throughout the country have those type of requirements. And when states look at our laws, they do not want to enter into an agreement with us because of that. And I would say that I would not be surprised if this bill were to pass, that those states that we have reciprocity with would be looking at our laws very closely, the changes that we made.
Senator Catano.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So you have you. Thank you for coming in, by the way.
Thank you.
Isn't it true that the way the law reads right now, a person can ask for a photograph? True or false?
I would have to look at it, but if somebody wanted me to take their photograph, I wouldn't have the ability to do it.
Madam Chair, follow up? No need to. If they want to take a photograph, by law, it's written in the laws that we have in the measure. Thank you.
Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm the president of the Londonderry Fishing Game Club. We are a club that has 1,300 members in the southern part of New Hampshire, some of the larger clubs. And one of the aspects we deal with in our club is training. We offer a lot of courses to train people on the use and handling and care of firearms. It's part of our mission statement. I myself am a certified firearms trainer. I'm here with another certified firearms trainer. So specifically going to this law here today, we're in support of the law. The bottom line is we agree with Senator Bradley that these changes aren't modest. I don't think it's really clear. I really appreciate what the trooper had to say, and very coherent. And working in the life license division, I certainly understand where he's coming from. The reality is, if this were to become law today, I don't think I would give up my pistol revolver license. I'm due for renewal this summer. I'm going to renew. I intend to, whether or not this law takes effect, because the fact is, I do travel in other states, and those other states honor my New Hampshire license. New Hampshire, it is true, in fact, that New Hampshire doesn't have a training requirement to obtain the license, but the very fact remains a very high number of people engage in training because they're responsible, lawful citizens. I don't think there's anybody that obtains a pistol revolver license is going to tell you that they know what there is to know and they're aptly prepared to use that pistol if the circumstances arise. I think responsible people do responsible things. And in the same respect, this pistol revolver license, making it optional, but yet still maintaining its good balance. I'm not sure, there might be some shrinking revenues, but we live in a world today where it's easy to travel. I don't think all of the revenues would be lost, or the majority of the revenues. I think a lot of folks would still maintain their pistol revolver licenses, given the fact they're similarly situated in life to life. I hunt in other jurisdictions, I fish in other jurisdictions. What's nice is I don't have to worry about going to Alaska salmon fishing, because I can carry a 500 magnum revolver with me when I go fishing, because the bears like to share my fish. But I'm able to protect myself. And I'm able to travel to Arizona for hunting down there, and they honor my New Hampshire pistol revolver license. I can go down to Pennsylvania and visit with my daughter in Richmond. They honor my New Hampshire pistol revolver license. So I think there are overwhelming many people that would maintain a pistol revolver license. So in terms of the revenue stream, I'm not sure there would be that much loss. Clearly, there'd be some loss. The other aspect of this is, the trooper got to it, it is in fact a misdemeanor. I like to believe that when our legislature enacts laws, we do so bearing in mind the totality and the gravity of the law violated. So instead of being a felony, carrying without a license, it's a misdemeanor. Obviously, we don't hear a lot about people being caught carrying without a license other than criminals. We hear about this criminal or that criminal, and they weren't allowed to have a firearm in the first instance, and most of the folks we hear about, we haven't really heard any instances where, there was a firearm in a vehicle and somebody was stopped and arrested. I mean, we very seldom hear about those circumstances. So this law, I believe, is a fairly decent correction. And I'm going to conclude right there. Thanks.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions from the committee? Senator Natama.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And Mr. Olson, one of the questions I asked Scott a while ago is about photograph. You're a trainer. Mm-hmm. Is it required or is it an option if the person wants a photograph?
I don't believe either exists. In terms of the license, Senator, I don't believe either exists. If a person wants a photo, I don't believe a lot of departments are set up to expend those resources to do that, nor is it a requirement on the license, pistol revolver license.
Follow up, Manager?
Yes.
If I have a license to carry, mm-hmm. can I go to the post office with that?
If you ask 25 different lawyers, you get 25 different answers. I'm not appropriately suited to answer that question. I know some will tell you yes, depending on You know, there's an exception within the law, and if there's a sign posted, others will tell you, no, absolutely not, under any circumstances. But for my own body of knowledge, I answered that a qualified no, because I'm not appropriately suited to answer that question.
Thank you. One last follow-up, Madam Chair. If you go down to the Pasture Center, whether you have a license or not, you better not go into that property. It's a federal government property. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you very much for your testimony. The chair, Mr. Olson,
yes.
we have an additional question. Would you be willing to say it?
No, that's my fault.
Okay. Yes, Senator Pierce.
Thank you, Mr. Olson. In reading the bill, I don't see. Thank you.
Sorry.
I don't see any age restrictions. So under the bill, could a 15-year-old carry a pistol or revolver without having to obtain a license?
I agree with you. There are no age restrictions delineated within this bill, or the current law for that matter. Inversely, I don't know of any licensing authorities that have issued pistol revolver licenses to 15-year-olds. I can only guess, my guess would be, theoretically, it could be done, but I don't know that it has been done. That's my best guess.
Yes.
Because we're a shall issue state, and because the bill imposes no age limitation, it seems as though a 15-year-old could carry concealed without a license. Would you be amenable to adding an age restriction to it to prevent minors from being able to carry concealed weapons?
No, I don't believe I would. And here's the reason why, okay? I believe that certain decisions are best left up to the parents, not to the state. I know of one instance many years ago where in Milford, New Hampshire, a 16-year-old was issued a pistol revolver license, and that 16-year-old was able to drive. It made the Channel 9 News, in fact, and that 16-year-old never had a problem. He got a permission slip from his mother and his father, and that individual is now an adult in his 30s and has never had a problem. So I think there's a very narrow, limited context when we start talking about youths and firearms, and some of those decisions are best left to individual families. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your, I'm sorry, Mr. Olson, we have another question. Senator Thomas.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just to make something clear, I have to thank the silent business, by the way, to read. If I may, it says here, it would require a license of a known drug abuser, anyone so far under the age of 18. Okay. This is a statement from the siren. Will also render invalid the administration rule to specify what may constitute an unsuitable person. This means other amendments will be detailed for someone who have been denied prior license or anyone under the age of 18.
I don't know what to tell you. That's the state police standard. You know, they have their permits and licensing bureau. Every department's different. Individual departments are different. I just stated the facts to you. I didn't state whether I advocated for it or was against it, you know, a 16, 17-year-old getting. All right. Well, again, I don't want to get into law. My understanding is if they're 18, they can't own or, I mean, purchase a firearm. They can possess a firearm, a handgun.
All right, thank you.
Is that clear?
Good enough.
Thanks. Okay, last call for questions here. Thank you very much, Mr. Olson, for being very patient with us today. Marie, I hope I haven't ruined your name there. Good luck.
My name is Chief Andrew Shigori. I'm here on behalf of the New Hampshire Association of Chiefs of Police, and we oppose this bill. To be fair, we oppose any bill that's come along to eliminate the requirement for having a license to carry a concealed weapon. This particular bill, though, is not modest. It is pretty radical in many ways. If you look at the last time something like this was proposed, in 2011, it was House Bill 536. It was actually a separate bill, and they were combined into one. That was sponsored primarily by Representative Hole. And before your august body, the Judiciary Committee, January 26, 2012, the recording is on the Senate website. Senator Groen asked the very question about age to Representative Hole. And Senator Groen asked if a six-year-old, if it passed, would be able to carry a loaded 45-volt concealed to school. Representative Holt said, while he didn't necessarily think it was a good idea or like the example, he said it would be covered under this law. That was more restrictive than what we have here, because all that did was kept the suitability part. Many questions have been raised about the law, this change on lines 11, where it says, unless the applicant is prohibited from, by New Hampshire statute, from, and it emphasizes this word, both owning and possessing a firearm. We have a few laws that address possessing. We don't have any laws that really address owning. For example, if somebody loses their firearms, if you will, for a restraining order, they do not surrender ownership. They're just prohibited for a period of time of possessing them. Theoretically, since both prongs of this would have to be satisfied for an issue of authority, which I've done for 16 years, almost 16 years, theoretically, you would have to issue that, because we still are, despite what you heard earlier, we still are a shall issue state. We still have to find suitability, and we still have to find that there's a proper purpose. So two prongs. So that's all we can look at. So it would be ridiculous for somebody to do that because you still can possess a firearm. But if they wanted to waste their $10, they would theoretically would have to issue that to them because they do not surrender ownership. As soon as that restraining order is up, the court will grant them that firearm back as long as they haven't been convicted of a crime. One of the things I heard earlier too is that 159.3, which talks about felons, prevents abusers. The vast majority of domestic violence cases in New Hampshire are misdemeanor level. Under this statute, as written, we will have to issue them concealed carry permits. They will be allowed, under New Hampshire law, to carry them concealed in vehicles loaded. When compared to other states, we talked about Vermont to our west, let's look to our east though. Maine, the second safest state, if you go by the violent crime. We were told earlier Vermont has 199 violent crimes per 100,000. Well, Maine is 121. Nearly the same. But Maine requires training before you get a license to carry. We also heard about Wyoming and Alaska and Arizona. I spent a lot of time looking at those statutes. In Wyoming, a non-resident cannot carry without a license. It only is for residents. And in Wyoming, to carry without a license, you still have to meet the licensing requirements, which largely mirror federal prohibitions, along with you can't, they have some verbiage about you can't excessively drink alcohol to the point of intoxication. That's grounds for denial in Wyoming of getting a license. And they also have a minimum age of 21. Alaska is 21, Arizona is 21, Vermont 16. We have no age limit. This passes, 13 and 14 year olds will be legally carrying a gun concealed, loaded. I mirror a lot of the concerns that the sergeant brought up. Right now, our law, we cannot require a photograph, we cannot require fingerprints. Again, Arizona, Wyoming, Alaska require those. They require training. Very few criminal record checks are truly effective without fingerprints. In fact, our law doesn't even mandate that a criminal record check be done. Most chiefs do them. I have heard an instance where it is not done. Agencies will issue them without doing the checks, especially in a renewal case. That's part of the reason why our license is not recognized by so many states. These other states, Alaska, Arizona, Wyoming, are recognized by far more states. Not only that, something that's kind of off topic, but a little bit on topic, because they're stricter, they qualify as a NICS exemption. Alaska, you have to file a separate form, a supplemental form. What that means is their criteria is fairly high, high enough that the federal government says you do not have to be subject to carrying to a NICS check to purchase a firearm. The other significant thing about being NICS exempt is under the federal gun-free school zones law, a state license issued in a state that meets the NICS requirement will allow you to carry within a school zone. Our license does not meet that criteria. I've heard some false information back when 536 was going around that our license did meet that, and it does not. I'll defer to a lot of other people I'm sure that want to talk, but I'll certainly answer any questions, and I will later submit some of my fine by my written testimony.
Thank you very much for your testimony, Senator Katama and Senator Pierce.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Would you like to see an amendment to this bill that was 18 years or older, another with a carry concealed or carry weapon in mantle order?
Well, again, we've traditionally had an opposition to it, repealing the requirement, which has been in place since 1923, to carry concealed weapon firearms. So just to add an age, we would still have, while I like that, it would not be in our support of the bill. I think it's prudent. As was pointed out, it has happened where minors have been issued them. The federal law prohibits purchase but not possession if you're under those ages, 18 for long guns, 21 for firearms. And quite frankly, we're the ones that deal more with it, more interaction at the state level than the federal level, the average gun owner. I guess I want to make one more point. People talk about people wanting to go commit a crime aren't going to be worried about the license, etc. That's somebody that's premeditated. That's somebody who's thinking ahead. Most crimes aren't committed under those circumstances. A lot of them are emotional. They're heat of the moment. So we're going to see, I think it's unsafe because there'll be more people carrying concealed and they could act in the heat of the moment, if you will. But, sorry.
Hey, thank you.
Senator Pierce?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Chief, did the bill sponsors reach out to the association for their input on this bill?
Not that I'm aware of. Certainly, it was my senator, he didn't contact me.
You're representing the association. Is there, are you aware of any difference of opinion on this bill within your association, or is it pretty uniform and in opposition?
Well, I can't say that we've talked to everybody within the association. There may be some that have different opinions, some may not have read it closely. But I think from those I've talked to, it's been uniform opposition, and it's been a long-standing policy over a number of years. I've been a chief for 16 years, but a lot of other chiefs have rotated, and the leadership has changed, and consistently over those years, we've opposed any bill that repeals a relatively lenient law on what a threshold to get a concealed carry license. Be aware that this is only, the license only allows you to carry concealed loaded. Carry concealed unloaded, which under court cases is that you don't have to have the ammunition in the gun. If you have a semi-automatic with a magazine next to it, you load up very fast, and you're still legal. You can also, it allows you to carry loaded in a car. Those are the big things it allows you to do, as opposed to just possess.
Yes.
We've heard that there are some assertions or some opinions that the bill would not increase harm or increase the risk of harm to the state. What is the association's opinion on that statement?
Well, I think, I don't know that we've taken a strict position on that. I think you're looking at, there'll be more people carrying concealed. There'll be people carrying that may not be able to otherwise in the past. And people like misdemeanor domestic violence abusers will will be able to be authorized under this bill to carry loaded concealed. Even though they're barred by federal law, you have to have a federal agent come in and enforce that, not a law-enforcement. And we're the ones that bump into these people. We're the ones who know who has these offenses in their background, not necessarily the federal agents which are invented.
And actually, I want to go to one of the first points that you made about the test at the front, where they're getting rid of the suitability standard. So the most applicants prohibited by the interest statute from both owning and possessing. Is it, and I want to try to understand, is it your position that because it says owning and possessing, and because there are no statutes in New Hampshire that address owning, that is it effectively no one's prohibited from getting a license?
I think an argument could be made, 159.3, which prohibits certain felons, doesn't prohibit all felons. I think an argument could be made that would prohibit them from owning. But in the case of a restraining order, they do not surrender ownership, they surrender possession. It's like I've got a car at home. I own it, but I don't possess it right now. Likewise with a firearm, they either have to surrender to the police or it gets turned into a licensed firearms FFL storage, but they do not surrender ownership. They still retain title to that unless they should have to forfeit it if they're convicted or if they decide to, on their volition, to sell it. But they retain ownership of it during a restraining order. We have to take reasonable care when we possess it.
So, under the language of the bill, even convicted felons would have to issue a license.
No, I do not believe so. I would argue that they cannot own under the clear. I believe that 159.3 doesn't necessarily say that, but I would argue that they cannot own it in any form. So I would say that a felon, I would deny a felon, and I'd like to see them challenge that in court. Because I don't believe that's appropriate. I believe most gun owners don't believe that's appropriate either. There might be some, but I think most of New Hampshire doesn't think that's appropriate. Likewise, some of the other prohibitions under the federal statute, those that have been committed to a mental institution due to dangerousness, or they're found incompetent or not guilty due to mental incompetence. Presently, that might be a suitability factor that we can look at. Under this bill, it's not.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good afternoon. Have you, it's been alluded to that this has been a bill, in search of a problem. Have you been aware of the problems existing with the law as it is now?
I don't believe so, but I suspect there's some that probably do, and that's why it's here. I think the law has worked. The present bill of law we have, I believe it was from 1979, the late 70s, I think it's been working pretty good, and I share the thought of the sergeant that if we loosen our standards to allow misdemeanor domestic violence people to be able to get a license, I suspect other states may want to look at our reciprocity with us. And there's not a problem with this bill where it talks about the reciprocity, since I brought that up. It alludes to once the director of the state police say they have reciprocity in this other state, it's forever. There's no provision in there for that to come off that. So if another state were suddenly to say, well, we're going to allow felons to carry under our license, let the feds deal with it, then we will still be stuck honoring their licenses. Because as I read it, there's no provision for removal.
Thank you.
One last question. Something's been sort of eating away at me, and it may not be particularly relevant, but I think it might be. But when the law was passed for, has it been a school of thought that those that carry concealed weapons are somehow more dangerous than two police officers or those fighting crimes and those who are out in the open?
I think when you carry concealed, I think there's
good afternoon.
I want to thank this committee for hearing my testimony, and I want to thank the sponsors of this bill. For the record, my name is Derek J. Wharton, and I'm a victim of this suitable person language that so many speakers find objectionable. In my experience, suitable is a way for police to deny a basic freedom to people they don't like. I'm a political activist who is vocal against abuse of authority in my town of Keene. I am not prohibited by New Hampshire or federal law from possessing a firearm and carrying it openly. I was denied my license to carry discreetly when I applied this summer. When I appealed the police chief's decision, he explained under oath that his decision was based on my political activism. This wouldn't be a problem for me if New Hampshire winter didn't require that I wear a coat. That would be a crime without a license. So I must disarm if I am to obey the law. It's my understanding that the right to bear arms is recognized as a natural right, which comes from our humanity, not from local police chiefs. I appealed my case to the New Hampshire Supreme Court, and it's before them now. I'm fortunate that I can afford that, but what about people who can't? One law enforcer who came up to speak on behalf of this bill said that there's a 30-day requirement for appeal, and that's true. But in my case, that didn't happen. And the only remedy was to wait longer. While I've had to spend thousands of dollars hiring an attorney to defend my natural rights, I ask that you make this appeal unnecessary by passing this bill. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony today. Are there any questions? Senator Lansky?
Apologize.
Getting late long. If I may ask, were you arrested for your political activism?
I have been arrested several times in Keene for acts of civil disobedience, yes.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Seeing none, thank you very much for your testimony.